Assalamualaikum. Hello everybody. So yesterday I did a Facebook live event answering questions about goals and also giving my 1 hour long sort of like a talk about the new year and goals and resolutions and so on and so forth. So it's a very lengthy and kind of a deep talk, so I highly recommend you watch that Facebook live event. It's recorded and I posted it on my Facebook page, Aiman Azlan 90, if you want to check the URL, or just write down Aiman Azlan in the Facebook search bar. And I did an Instagram Q&A to collect questions from people to answer during the Facebook live event. But what happened was, after the Facebook live event, a lot of you still ask me questions on Instagram stories. So I don't want to waste the questions. So I decided, okay, let's do an Instagram live pula hari ni. So this is Instagram live. Okay. So thank you very much for joining in. Wow. A lot of you. Okay. Waving. Hi. So I'm just going to go straight to the questions that you guys ask on Instagram stories and just go dive into it. All right. Now, the topic here is about goals, resolutions, new year, 2019, and so on, right? Okay. How to convince someone bila dia rasa down dengan result dia? So, I'm guessing this refers to exam results. So, or whatever result lah. So, basically, you have a friend yang tak dapat apa dia nak and dia rasa down. Macam mana nak convince dia? So, you as a friend lah tanya soalan ni. Okay. So, first thing first. You as a friend, you can realize two things. Number one, you cannot control your friend too. As much as you would love to help your friend to the maximum, you have to understand the limitation. The limitation here is that change can only happen if the person wants to change. That's it. That's like the basic rule. If you learn counseling, you as a counselor, one of the first thing you will learn is that change will not happen unless your client wants the change. That's it. It's very simple, but it's very difficult to internalize because, you know, this is your friend or maybe your family member, and it's hard to digest that, oh, I can't do anything unless this person help himself first, which is really, really difficult to accept. But it is the reality. So that's the first thing. The second thing you have to realize is that you have to know your realm as the friend. In my estimation, you as the friend, the thing that you need to do is, number one, you need to be a good listener. So you need to listen. A good listener is somebody who can lower the ego, can lower any assumption that he or she might have, and lower any type of interpretation, pre-interpretation that the other person already has about this friend. So empty out your mind and just listen to the story, because it's all in the story. What is the story? Because what you see is the ending of the story. You don't know the story yet. So if you want to help your friend, really help your friend, be a good listener first. And then once you understand, this happened, and then this happened, and this happened, that's why this person is this way, then you'll be able to find the best possible course of action for you to take as the friend. And what is that best course of action exactly? I don't know. You should know better than me, because you are his friend. And because you are his friend, you know his personality, you know his temperament, you know what he likes, what he dislikes. So you know best how to approach him in the best possible manner. But you need to know the story first. So that's my answer lah. Second question, how many goals should we have? As many as you want. There's no limitation, man. But obviously. Even though there's no limitation, you can have as many goals as you want. Really, really, really. I'm not kidding. I'm not like, this is not a joke. You can have as many goals as you want. Yeah. But be realistic in terms of your capabilities, your talents, the time that you have, the resources that you have available, and also what you find to be motivating for you. So, if you take all those things into account, you realize that your realistic goals are limited, but all of the limited goals that you have are worthwhile. And if you just focus on those limited goals, you will find that your life is worth living. Inshallah, really, you will find that your life is worth living. So how many goals should you have? As many as you like, but be realistic in terms of your capabilities, your talents, your motivation, your passion, your resources, and your circumstances. So be realistic with that. My goal is to find out what my life goals are. Is that a goal? I'm not sure if you're being clever with that question, but I always take every question seriously, so I think this is a serious question. I believe this is a serious question. So really, underneath this question is a story. I don't know what the story is, but I can guess, this is just a guess, a speculation, that this person is clueless about what to do with his or her life, which is a very serious thing and is very, very common. So the first thing I would like to say is that if you are in this situation where you have no idea what your goal should be, what your goal is, because you don't know who you are, you don't know what to do with your life, you have no idea, you're clueless, the first thing you need to understand is that you are not alone. And trust me when I say that, because I have encountered so many people with this particular problem. So you have to understand you're not the only one. You're not alone. Okay, having said that, if you want to figure out what to do with your life, you can start by a few things. Number one, you can start with an imagination. Okay, what kind of life would you want? Or what kind of life, in your best estimation, best guess, again, what kind of life that if you were to live that life, it wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. Let's start with like the most the lowest possible goal that you can achieve, right? So if let's say in 5 years time, and let's say you were to have a time machine and you can go 5 years in the future to meet yourself in the future in 5 years, okay, what would you hope to see? That's it. Ask yourself that question. What would you hope to see in 5 years when you meet yourself in 5 years? Would you hope to see that you have a stable career? Would you hope to see that you have a family, maybe a children somehow? Would you hope to see that you have a business or whatever? So what do you hope to see if you have a time machine, you can go 5 years into the future and meet yourself? Take that vision and treat it as a goal. So you have a vision now because you already imagined it. So now, put that vision into words, because if you keep it in your mind, it becomes abstract, and abstraction is not that good if you want to really, really plan out a strategy. So put that vision into words. So take a piece of paper, pen, and start writing down, or use your computer or smartphone or whatever. Start writing down what that vision is and be as specific as possible. And then now you have that goal concrete because you write it down. Awesome. Like for me, I love to write down things on whiteboard. I have a whiteboard here in my office. Can I show you? Yeah, I can show you. Yeah. This is my whiteboard. See? Yeah. I love to write down things on my whiteboard because, like I said, if you keep things in your head, it becomes abstract. So, but if you write it down, it becomes concrete. So when I write my ideas down, I can start to see like connections. I can start to see things in a bigger picture. I can look at the macro, and I can start to play around with what I write down. And that's good. That's great. And once you have that, then you look at where you are now and just, you can start with a guess. It's okay. Because you're clueless, it's okay. You can start with a guess. If I want to go there, that goal, that vision, and I'm here right now, here, okay, what's the next step that I can take that could possibly take me a bit closer to that goal? And that's it. That's your homework. That's what you should do with your life next. So you can make a to-do list, you can start planning a schedule of your day or whatever, any type of progress that you can muster to actually go a little bit closer to that particular vision that you have right now. Wow, that's a very long answer, but I guess it's very, very relevant to not just this person, but so many young people out there that I know have the same question. All right. This is a relationship question. It's kind of long. Okay. Since this is not a relationship Q&A, so I'll just, you know, for a later time. All right. How to be like really, really istiqamah or consistent. All right. So full disclosure, I made a video on YouTube about this particular issue, about istiqamah. It outlines my basic idea, concept, and also understanding about istiqamah and how I deal with istiqamah. So you can go to my YouTube channel. Again, Aiman Azlan 90. It's so easy to find me online. Aiman Azlan 90. Go to YouTube and find the video about istiqamah. You can just search istiqamah Aiman Azlan. InsyaAllah, you'll find it. So just, that's it. Bila goal tak tercapai, tapi kita nak sangat capai goal tu. So, how to set our course again to capai goal tu. So, okay. So, you ada goal, you try, you fail, tapi you nak try lagi. So, macam mana? Alright. When you try something to reach a goal and then you fail. Number one, failure is not the end of the road. Like I said in my Facebook Live event yesterday, failure is not a gravestone. Failure is a stepping stone. What does it mean? If you see failure as a gravestone, it literally means that you like die lah after that failure. So you're like, bela, this is the end. Tak apa dah. No, failure is a stepping stone. So macam batu loncatan, stepping stone. It propels you to go somewhere else. So when you fail in trying something that you really, really want to do, learn from that failure and then whatever lessons that you have, apply that lesson in your next trial and then see how it goes. And you can repeat this over and over and over again until you reach that goal. But even if you do not reach that goal, it's not a waste of time because every trial that you took is a lesson. And every time you learn that lesson, you grow as a person. So even though you do not reach that goal, you still grow as a person. And that is not a waste of time. And if anything, every effort you take, if you do it in the right way, and you do it because you want to become better, then in my estimation, that counts as pahala as well. So rewarded by Allah as well. So good for you. My friend say, aku tak ada hala tuju lagi. Okay, what should I say to him back? Aku tak ada hala tuju lagi. Well, I guess I answered that question before. So you can, after this live event, you can watch again what I say about goal is a very long answer about, you know, vision yourself 5 years in the future and so on. It's hard to achieve goals when I always procrastinate. How to change? Okay, as a procrastinator myself, I am guilty of this as well. Okay, so how I am still dealing with my procrastination is that I always remind myself of why I'm doing this. Sounds cliche, but hear me out. Your why is your motivation, and the reason why you procrastinate is because you have this tendency to feel good in the short term, as opposed to feel good in the long term. The Malay, we have this saying, susah-susah dahulu, senang-senang kemudian. So which is a really, really, like, if you really think about it, what it actually says is that if you want, like, long-term success or long-term senang, You have to be willing to experience susah-susah dahulu. What that means is that when you procrastinate, you want senang sekarang. That's what procrastination is. You nak senang sekarang. Because procrastination, to me, is an escape strategy. You're trying to escape something that you don't want to face. Like, for example, you have this big assignment, you have this big mark. So you want to escape that, you procrastinate. And that is actually supported by science as well, because when I study procrastination, You can do it too. You can Google and study about research done on procrastination. One of the reasons is because you fear failure. You fear messing up. You fear making mistakes. And because you don't want to face that fear, you distract yourself or you escape by doing something else other than this thing. But the funny, ironic thing about that is that procrastination will kind of guarantee you failure. So that's the funny thing. But then, if you procrastinate an assignment, for example, right, and you just hold it off until the very, very last minute, the very, very last night, and then you just start doing your assignment, it gives you an excuse. So let's say, for example, you procrastinated and you left your assignment to the very last minute, and then you did not get a good mark. Well, you can justify to yourself, patutlah dapat markah rendah, aku buat last minute, kalau aku buat awal-awal kan. And that makes you feel better about yourself. But, deep down, if you search inside your soul, you know that you're just lying to yourself. Because you know that, bukan nak kata, aku buat last minute ke apakah, I chose to do last minute. So it's 100% my fault. But I don't want to say it is my fault. Because if I say it is my fault, then I have to do something. And that doesn't feel good. I don't want to do anything. I just want to accept myself as, you know, good enough or whatever. Well, motivation-wise, you are good enough. But in this particular case, you are making good enough as an excuse, a cheap excuse to escape responsibility. And that's not good. That's not good. So how do you deal with procrastination? Just always remember your why. And make sure that your why is bigger and stronger than the immediate reward that you are seeking right now. Kan nak senang sekarang tu. Make sure your why tu adalah lebih kuat daripada keinginan nak senang sekarang tu. But if your why tu tak berapa kuat sangat, dan dia kalah lah dengan keinginan nak senang sekarang tu. Because procrastination is in simple terms, you nak senang sekarang. That's basically why you procrastinate. You nak senang sekarang. You tak nak susah sekarang and senang kemudian. Alright, how to create monthly goal. Okay, how to create monthly goal. Alright, monthly goal. Okay, you can add a timeline lah kan. You can add a timeline basically. What's short term, what's medium term, what's long term. Okay, long term, like if you go to my Twitter page, again, Aiman Azlan 90. I posted like my life goal, which is that like the long term goal. So I have like, I want financial freedom. I want to become a counselor and clinical psychologist. I want to own a cafe business. I want to own a bookstore. So those are my like dreams, aspiration goals for the long term. Now, once you have that long-term goal, now you have a vision of who you want to be in the future. That's motivation because you see, that's what I want, yes! But now you have to break it down. Okay, so how can you get there? Right, you want to go to Kuala Lumpur from Perlis, so you have to like plan your route. So how do you want to get there? You have to first go to Kedah, and then you have to go to Penang, and you have to go to Perak, and you have to go to... After Perak is Selangor lah. So that's the monthly goal. Like from Perlis to Kedah, and Kedah to Penang, Penang to Perak, and Perak to boom, KL, your long-term goal. Sampai. So you kena ada long-term goal dulu, and then from that long-term goal you pecahkan, you create your monthly goal. Okay, how can I achieve that? And from that monthly goal pula, you boleh pecah lagi. Weekly goal. And then from that weekly goal, you pecah lagi. Daily goal. So that becomes your map of life lah. So when you wake up in the morning, you macam, I know what to do today. As opposed to you wake up in the morning macam, alamak nak buat apa hari ni. Or you wake up in the morning macam, alamak nak pergi kerja sekali lagi. It becomes this like very, very, very painful circle of life macam, kerja, balik, tidur, kerja, balik, tidur, kerja, balik, tidur. And you become this wheel. You just pusing, tapi tak ke mana. Macam hamster tau. So that's not good. But if you have a like long-term goal, you punya wheel tu bergerak ke depan. Tak macam hamster wheel. So that's the difference lah. At least bila you pergi kerja every day, you macam tahu, okay, this is another step forward towards that long-term goal. Anyway, kita teruskan dengan soalan seterusnya. Yakin tu penting, tapi kalau terlebih yakin macam mana? Kita yakin gila yang kita dapat achieve goal tu. And then lelah kali tak dapat, macam mana? Okay, confidence, keyakinan, it's bagus. Memang bagus. You kena yakin dengan you punya goal tu. You kena, bila you set goal tu, you kena yakin, ah, aku boleh dapat goal tu. But at the same time, you kena balance out dengan reality, okay? Okay, you yakin, you hopeful, dan you betul-betul boleh rasa lah goal tu dapat. But at the same time, you kena ada a little bit of room, a little bit of ruang untuk nak entertain the possibility, okay, aku mungkin tak akan dapat goal tu. And that's not you being like pessimistic sangat ke apa ke. You just being balanced lah kan. Because kalau you yakin sangat, terlalu yakin, and then you tak dapat, you akan self-destruct. But then kalau you yakin, and then you balance out dengan, okay, mungkin tak dapat, tapi still aku rasa boleh dapat. And then you fail, you it's okay. You jatuh, you sakit, tapi taklah macam jatuh sangat. So you kena balance out between like hope, and then between hope and fear, basically. Between hope and fear, you kena balance out. You tak boleh. Itu pun dalam Islam juga dia ajar. You kena balance hope dengan fear. You tak boleh takut sangat neraka sampai you tak boleh nak hidup. You tak boleh juga macam mengharapkan syurga sangat sampai you rasa macam, ha, tak apalah, Allah akan maafkan aku. Everything aku buat, aku, Allah maafkan aku. That's not good. Too extreme, not good. You kena balance out di tengah-tengah. Okay. What are your marriage goals? Oh my god, what are your marriage goals? Okay. To be really, 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 really honest with you, my marriage goal with my wife is to die together. Oh, but hear me out, okay? What do I mean by that? In the very beginning, when I married my wife, obviously I love her, I admire her, I am attracted to her, interested about her, semua tu lah. But then, I don't think of her as this like perfect, flawless angel ke apa ke. And she doesn't think of that of me. Because dia ada, dia punya kecacatan dia, kekurangan dia, kelemahan dia, benda-benda perangai-perangai yang annoying dia, saya pun ada juga. So, I always try to balance out between my admiration of my wife and the reality that she is human being. What does that mean about, what does that have to do with the goal? The goal is that when I enter into this contract of marrying her, I'm saying whatever happens, tak kisahlah pahit macam mana pun, tak kisahlah you ni annoying macam mana pun, tak kisahlah aku ni marah macam mana pun, I will not leave you. I will still be there. I will still be by your side. We will work this out and we will die together. That's basically my marriage goal. Is I want to, whatever happens, bergaduh macam mana ke, merajuk macam mana ke, apa konflik ke, kesusahan, kepayahan hidup yang terjadi dalam marriage ini, whatever happens, my goal is that we will make this work. I don't care. We will make this work. We will try our best. We will improve ourselves. We will improve each other. We will improve this house so that we will sail through the ocean of life with all the big waves and we will reach our destination together. That's like the marriage goal lah in my mind. What should we do kalau setiap doa kita tak dimakbulkan? Okay, ada beberapa perkara dalam soalan tu yang menarik tau. Number one, setiap doa kita. The thing about kita ni kan, kita kena sentiasa berhati-hati dengan bahasa yang kita gunakan untuk describe situation kita. So, saya tanya soalan ni kepada you. Betul ke setiap doa you tidak termakbul? Setiap doa you. You know what that means? That means, from the very beginning of your life until today, setiap doa you tak termakbul. Literally, itulah maksud dia. Bila you kata, setiap doa aku tidak termakbul. Just imagine that. Imagine that. How many doa yang you dah ucapkan? Daripada you mula hidup lah kan, sampai ke hari ni. Katakanlah umur you 20 tahun. Berapa ribu, raban, juta doa you dah sebut. And you nak kata semua doa tu tak termakbul? Really? Be very careful. Because that's what you are saying. And if that is what you are saying, then what's your perception of Allah then? Macam mana tu? Now, I'm not like guilt-tripping you anything. No, I'm not doing that. I'm just trying to lead you to this self-reflection contemplation area so that you re-evaluate your situation. Itu je. Re-evaluate your situation. Betul ke? Tak ada satu pun doa you yang termakbul. Cuba test yang tu dulu. And cuba tengok in your past experience, ada tak at least satu? At least satu doa yang you minta ke Allah, dapat. And tulis doa tu. Doa tu apa? And apa yang you dapat tu? Because once you find at least one, then this statement hancur terus. And I believe you akan jumpa at least one. I believe so. 100% guarantee I believe so. Because I believe yang Allah tidak akan bazirkan mana-mana doa hamba dia. Because doa ni dia boleh makbul dalam beberapa cara. Ini part 2 of this answer. Part 2. Tadi part 1. Ni part 2 dia. Part 2 dia adalah cara Allah makbulkan doa you, doa saya, doa kita tidak semestinya mengikut apa yang kita harapkan. So kalau you doa, aku berdoa, aku boleh kahwin dengan lelaki tu. Tak semestinya Allah makbulkan doa you dengan bagi you lelaki tu. Tak semestinya. Mungkin Allah tak bagi you lelaki tu, tapi Allah bagi you lelaki lain. Because of your doa. Itu cara Allah jawab doa you. So when you berdoa kepada Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, you kena percaya yang Allah akan jawab. Number one, Allah jawab. Allah jawab semua doa. Guarantee. Guarantee Allah menjawab semua doa. Dia cakap dalam Quran. Kalau apa ayat surah Al-Baqarah tu, Allah hai. I respond to the call of the caller. Tu bahasa Inggeris lah. Bahasa Arab dia tak ingat. I respond to the call of the caller. Maknanya aku sentiasa respond kepada mereka yang berdoa. Siapa-siapa saja yang berdoa, Allah akan respond. Nah, respon Allah tu macam mana? Ah, itu dia. Respon Allah tu tak semestinya ikut apa you nak. Because that's not your right. You, me, kita, manusia adalah hamba sahaja. Doa ni bukan demand tau. Doa ni permintaan. Okay? Kena faham tu. Doa ni permintaan. You minta je. You bukan demand. So, kalau you rasa macam, kenapa aku buat doa tak dapat? Mungkin you fikir doa tu demand. Mungkin. Mungkin lah. Saya tak tahu. Saya tak tahu. You kena contemplate and reflect lah. Saya mana tahu kan? So, you kena re-evaluate balik, ada tak doa you yang termakbul? Ataupun bukan terlah makbul. Makbul. Bukan ter macam tak sengaja pula kan? Yang makbul. Satu. And dua, you kena re-evaluate balik cara you conceptualize macam mana Allah respon. Okay? Allah tidak respon ikut keinginan you. Allah respon ikut apa yang terbaik untuk you. Beza tu. And kalau you ada anak kecil, you akan faham benda ni. Pasal tak semua benda yang anak you nak, you bagi. Pasal ada banyak benda yang dia nak, tak bagus untuk dia. And you sebagai parent, you tahu, okay, this is not good for you, I'm not going to give it to you. Tapi macam mana anak tu respon? Obviously, dia akan tantrum, dia akan menangis, dia akan marah sebab anak tu tak tahu lagi yang benda tu tak baik untuk dia. Sama juga macam kita. Kadang-kadang kita ni macam budak-budak kan. Allah pun takkan bagi benda yang tak bagus untuk kita. Walaupun kita rasa macam, benda ni bagus untuk aku. Tapi kenapa Allah tak bagi? Well, mungkin sebab benda tu tak bagus. And you mana tahu pun. Kan, you rasa benda tu bagus tapi Allah maha mengetahui dan Allah tak lebih tahu yang benda tu tak bagus untuk you. Kalau you nak lebih tahu lagi benda ni, saya sure kan, you study pasal doa istikharah. Doa istikharah. Ni tak ada kaitan dengan kahwin eh. Istikharah ni ada kaitan dengan pemilihan. So, you nak pilih apa dalam hidup. So, life is a series of choices and consequences. Itu saya pernah cakap. Life is a series of choices and consequences. So, istikharah adalah doa untuk kita nak memilih. So, kita nak minta, kita nak counsel Allah untuk like tunjuk kepada kita pilihan aku ni okey ke tak okey, dan termasuklah nak kahwin kan, pasal kita nak memilih. Tapi tak juga, tak semestinya kahwin you nak pilih kereta A atau kereta B, ataupun nak pilih rumah A atau rumah B, you nak pilih kos A ke kos B, program A ke program B, universiti A ke university, you nak memilih. So you minta, you istikharah kepada Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. Okey, so studilah doa istikharah tu, highly recommended. Doa tu saya katakan personally sebagai saya adalah ubat kepada sakit hati. Kepada saya lah. So, bila saya sakit hati ke, tak dapat benda yang saya nak. So, saya ingat balik doa istikharah and then saya macam rasa lega balik lah. Tips berhadapan dengan orang yang ego. Jangan ego juga. Senang. Jangan lawan api dengan api. Macam mana nak cure addiction kepada maksiat seperti zina? Macam mana nak cure addiction kepada maksiat seperti zina? So, bila you cakap zina ni, adakah you maksudkan zina as in seks luar nikah? Ataupun zina macam zina mata ke, atau zina tangan ke? So, I'm assuming this is a package punya soalan kot. Macam zina keseluruhan termasuklah zina seks luar nikah tu. So, macam mana nak cure addiction kepada certain... Okay. Aiman Amri, Aiman Psychologist, ada buat video pasal pornography addiction dekat ML Studio. So, you masuk YouTube, you type ML Studio, Aiman Psychologist, porn addiction. Ataupun ketagihan porn. Tak ingat apa tajuk dia. Tapi something pasal ketagihan pornografi lah. Aiman Amri ataupun Aiman Psychologist buat video tu. So, you can use that video macam satu foundation lah untuk you faham macam mana you nak lawan. Bukan cure tau. Lawan. Macam mana you nak lawan you punya addiction tu. Okay? It's a good practical punya advice lah. And I highly recommend you check video tu. I just finished my degree in psychology but I don't have confidence to work. Okay. Alright. Just finished degree in psychology but I don't have confidence to work. Number one. You belajar apa dalam psychology? Because really, psychology is about understanding human beings and understanding yourself. And part of that is you have to learn how to understand your motivations, how to understand your demotivations, how to understand what drives you, and how to understand what caused you to go down. And once you have this understanding, you should be able to at least map out what you want to do with your life. That's what psychology is all about. It's about improving your state of being so that you can become the best version of who you can be. That's psychology. And it comes from this understanding of human beings. Understanding the mind, the behavior. So, really, saya nak tanya, you belajar apa dalam psychology? Ni bukan soalan marah tau. No, this is soalan self-reflection. Okay, ni soalan self-reflect. Saya nak you self-reflect. Apa you belajar dalam psychology tu? You ambil degree ni sebab nak memahami subjek tu ke? Nak memahami ilmu tu ke? Nak apply ilmu tu ke? Ataupun you ambil sebab, I don't know, psychology ni trendy ke apa-apa. Psychology ni macam hipster ke apa-apa. So, you kena evaluate balik you punya motivation. Macam saya ambil psikologi sebab saya minat gila-gila dengan topik, subjek, ilmu tu. Saya nak faham, saya nak hadam, saya nak lagi. Macam betul-betul addicted. Nampak buku belakang ni? Ni, majoritinya pasal psikologi. Dan cikgu tak suruh beli pun. Saya masuk bookstore, saya terus cari buku-buku yang pasal psikologi. Tak semestinya buku tu kena dalam section psikologi. Tak semestinya. Kadang-kadang buku psikologi tu saya jumpa pada bahagian politik, pada bahagian ekonomi. Sebab bila you dah ada that mentality, you dah ada that framework and that lens, you nampak macam everything related dengan benda you belajar tau. This is the amazing thing about ilmu. Ilmu ni related tau. So, saya belajar psikologi tapi saya juga minat ekonomi, finance, saya minat politik, saya minat religion. Obviously, religion is like the core of my being. So, memang. Tapi, saya juga minat religion. Bukan setakat saya macam, oh, kena jadi Muslim. Tak, saya minat jadi Muslim. So, this different thing kan. So, that's the first thing. You kena re-evaluate you punya motivation, which is very, very important. The second thing is that I don't have confidence to work. Okay, I'm just going to make a guess pasal you tak specify puncanya apa. Mungkin sebab you rasa macam psikologi ni tak ada kerja, betul tak? Sebab ramailah. Oh, saya dapat banyaklah soalan daripada student. Saya degree psikologi tapi nak kerja apa sebenarnya? And maybe that's one of the reason kenapa you tak rasa confident. Maybe lah, saya tak tahu. Saya kata maybe sahaja. So, macam mana? Okay. You kena re-evaluate balik what is the definition of job. Apakah itu job, apakah itu career, apakah itu work. Okay? So, for me, a job tidak semestinya orang kena hire saya. Okay? A job could be I become my own boss. That's one definition of a job. Yang lain daripada definition yang biasa. I'm not saying you buat business ke apa ke. Tak. Saya just nak buka minda you supaya you fikir career, job, work ni dia lebih besar daripada apa yang you sangkakan selama ini. Okay, let me give you a bigger concept, okay? This is a bigger concept. For me, if I find in the community something yang missing, yang saya rasa saya boleh fill in, and saya ada skill, saya ada value, saya ada capacity untuk nak fill in that emptiness, that's a job. Tahniah, you jumpa job. Because pasti ada somebody somewhere out there yang sanggup bayar you, tak semestinya orang tu boss. Mungkin you figure out a solution and then you, well, for lack of better term, you sell your solution and dia ada orang akan beli. Because the world is full of problems and the world has enough problems for every single human being to solve. So akan ada masalah dalam dunia ni yang you boleh solve. Akan ada. Pasti. I'm 100%. 100% confident yang akan mesti ada masalah dalam dunia ni yang you boleh solve. And once you find that problem yang you boleh solve, solve that problem to the best of your capacity and you have a job, my friend. That's a job. And you kena present that to the world yang, hey, aku ada skill ni, ini yang aku boleh buat, this is a problem that I can solve, therefore, you guys should be on board. And that's a skill that you have to learn lah. It's part of the journey of life. And to that end, because you kata saya tak ada confident kan? Iklan sikit. Esok, tomorrow, I have an online class at 8 p.m. Malaysia time about how to build self-confidence. Because I look at these questions and one theme usually pops up is that people lack confidence. Selalulah, sama ada masalah tentang relationship ke, masalah tentang university ke, masalah tentang career ke, masalah tentang parents ke, masalah tentang adik-beradik ke. Banyak, banyak benda dalam masalah-masalah tu ada kaitannya dengan self-confidence yang kurang. Contohnya, you tak ada confident nak bercakap dengan orang tu. You tak ada confident nak face the conflict. You tak ada confident nak face the crowd untuk public speaking. You tak ada confident nak cakap BI. Sebab you takut nak buat silap. So all those things, and you kat sini you tak ada confident nak bekerja. So all those things ada kaitan dengan self-confidence. So I will teach you how to build self-confidence. There's a 2-hour class happening tomorrow night, 8 p.m. Saturday. Hopefully you are free. Please, please join that class because that's my way of providing solution to this problem. Because I have Alhamdulillah, this is not me being arrogant. Alhamdulillah, this is a ni'mah that Allah gave to me. I have an answer to the question. Just one of many answers possible out there. So if you're interested, please attend the class. How to attend the class? Go to my website, aimanazlan.com. aimanazlan.com. Ulang balik, aimanazlan.com. And then you will see a banner about the class. So the class is tomorrow night, and the last, okay, let me extend lah. Okay, last time untuk nak register, let's say originally saya nak tutup registration malam ni, tapi let me extend. I'll extend the registration for the class, for the online class. Online je, you tak payah keluar rumah pun, online class. I'll extend the registration until tomorrow Saturday. Let's say about 5 p.m. Okay lah, okay. Tomorrow Saturday 5 p.m. registration stop. Okay, and then 8 p.m. Kelas bermula. So tu memang, kalau you procrastinator kan, you want tunggu sampai 4:59 lah nak register kan. But hopefully not lah, hopefully not. So please join the class. It's about how to build self-confidence. It's based on my best-selling book. Oh, ada kat sini. It's based on my best-selling book, Unshakable. Woo, promote lagi. How to be confident when you are nervous, which is actually been the top 10 MPH best-selling list sejak dilancarkan lah buku ni. Jadi top 10 sampai ke hari ni. Alhamdulillah, I'm forever grateful. Thank you very much for those of you who already bought the book, read the book and benefited from the book. And I don't think this is about me though. I think the book sells great because of the content. Because like I said, a lot of these problems are self-confidence issues. And I think it's because of the content yang people beli buku tu. So I don't think it's about me though. So yeah, you can buy this book at MPH Bookstore, either online or at the bookstore itself. with a 25% discount right now, because there's an offer happening right now. So you can buy the book at MPH Bookstore, online or offline. Thank you very much for that. Okay. Ada lagi soalan ni. Ha, berapa lama dah ni online ni? Aku pun tak tahu. Ada komen ke? Aku pun tak tahu. Macam mana nak check komen Ada komen ke? Ada orang tanya soalan ke? Ada ke? Oh, ada orang tanya soalan. Oh, sorry. Ya Allah, aku tak perasan. Apa soalan dia? Okay. Salman Salahuddin. Assalamualaikum, bro. How to be so friendly with people? Like, mudah mesra dengan kebanyakan orang. Okay. Okay, Salman. This is a skill tau. Ini satu skill yang kita boleh belajar. Tapi, skill ni, well, it depends lah. You introvert ke extrovert? Now, saya bukan nak guna label tu sebagai satu absolute term tau, because nak kena terangkan dulu ni. Introvert extrovert ni adalah satu spectrum. So you can imagine macam line spectrum, macam spectrum cahaya tu kan, yang belajar waktu sains tu kan. So spectrum. So the extreme right adalah let's say introversion, and the extreme left adalah extroversion. So extreme. Kita semua duduk di atas spektrum tu. Okay? Cumanya kita lebih kat mana? Kita lebih dekat extrovert ke? Kita lebih dekat introvert? So, dia ada degree of kekuatan yang lebih ke situ, lebih ke sini. Saya, for example, saya lebih ke arah extrovert. Tetapi, saya ada a big part of introversion in me. So, macam ada ketika tu saya nak bersendirian. Saya nak bersendirian dengan pemikiran saya. Ada ketika tu saya nak bersosial. So, macam saya duduk atas pentas, saya rasa energetic, saya rasa very, very good bila saya atas pentas bercakap dengan orang. So, saya ada dua-dua sekali lah. Ada juga term orang panggil ambivert lah. Tapi, saya macam half-half sikit tentang ambivert ni. Bagi saya lebih berpegang kepada the big five personality theory tu. Yang mana dia tak panggil lah ambivert ke apa ke. Dia just macam kata, okay, kita ada campuran. Kita semua ada campuran. Cuma ada setengah orang tu, dia lebih sangat ke arah extrovert. Dia sikit introvert. Ada orang lebih sangat ke arah introvert, sikit je extrovert. Now, introvert-extrovert ni bukannya macam, oh, introvert teruk, extrovert baik. No! This is a personality type. Dia bukannya macam penyakit ke apa ke. No. Extrovert bagus, introvert bagus. Semua bagus. Cumanya setiap satu tu ada kelemahan dan kelebihan. Itu je. Ya, extrovert, walaupun kita nampak macam, oh, dia ni, oh, everything, semua benda dia boleh buat. Tak, extroversion pun ada kelemahan dia juga sebenarnya. Introvert pula, kita rasa macam, alamak, antisocial, pemalu. Dia pun ada banyak kelebihan yang kita tak faham sebagai masyarakat. Sebab kita tak faham this idea of introvert-extrovert. Kita nampak macam introvert, antisocial, pemalu, tak suka orang. Sebenarnya, introvert ni bukan tak suka orang. No. Antisocial ni, it's a different thing altogether tau. It's not introversion. Introvert ni adalah orang yang dia rasa letih cepat bila dia dengar orang. Dia letih cepat bila dia dengar orang. Bukan dia tak suka. Dia suka. Manusia. Kenalah suka orang kan. Cuma dia rasa letih cepat bila dengar orang. So, dia lebih suka bersendirian. Bila dia bersendirian, dia dapat energy tu. So introvert ni jenis-jenis orang yang suka berfikir, suka bersendirian, suka baca buku, benda-benda yang membolehkan dia bersama dengan diri sendiri. Dia suka benda tu, dia rasa energy. Extrovert terbalik. Kalau orang extrovert duduk kat library, 5 minit dia keluar. Dia tak boleh. Sebab extrovert ni dia perlukan socialization, dia perlukan orang, dia perlukan like feedback back and forth, dia perlukan social environment. Dia tak boleh duduk seorang-seorang. Bila dia duduk seorang, dia letih. To extrovert. Now, having said that, itu just very, 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 very condensed explanation lah. Ada lagi banyak benda boleh cakap. Now, how to be so friendly with people? Okay, I'm assuming this is maybe you are the introversion lebih sikit. So, macam mana nak bagi friendly dengan orang? Okay, number one, you tak perlu tukar introvert kepada extrovert. Tak perlu. Actually, you tak boleh tukar pun. Pasal personality ni benda yang relatively stable over time. Maksud dia bukanlah macam boleh kalau you extremely extrovert, tiba-tiba boleh jadi extremely introvert. Kalau benda tu terjadi, something is wrong. Now, but you boleh adjust and adapt kepada you punya environment, kepada kehendak environment you. So in this case, kehendak environment you adalah you nak lebih bersosial dengan orang, more friendly dengan orang. So you boleh adopt adapt and adjust by learning new skills. So you dah identify diri you sebagai introvert. Sebagai contoh, katakanlah aku ni introvert, aku lebih suka bersendirian, aku lebih suka dalam pemikiran aku. Fine, good, no problem. But aku still kena belajar skill nak bersosial dengan orang. So you kena belajar benda tu. So sebagai kepada seorang introvert, mungkin you kena plan cara nak bersosial dengan orang ataupun bila nak bersosial dengan orang. So you plan bila nak keluar dengan kawan, you plan bila nak pergi keluar ngawayang ke, pergi keluar makan-makan ke, you plan bila nak pergi benda-benda tu, benda-benda bersosial tu. And then you plan juga, okay, bila aku dalam keadaan macam ni, okay, apa yang patut aku buat? Bukannya macam ada skrip, tak, bukan. Macam you macam ada at least a guideline dalam kepala you, macam mana nak buat. Sebab mungkin you tak ada that spontaneous capability untuk nak bersosial dengan orang secara friendly. You tak spontaneous tau, you kena plan. Now, extrovert, mungkin bagi dia, benda tu spontaneous. Dia tak perlu belajar, dia tak perlu macam nak plan-plan ke apa ke. Dia spontaneously friendly dengan orang. Tapi at the same time, dia pula, extrovert ni, dia tak boleh duduk diam. Nah, dia tak boleh nak bersendirian. Dia tak boleh nak berfikir, contemplate, meditate. Which is not good sebenarnya tau. You kena ada time yang mana you kena macam bersendirian, tafakur kan. Dalam Islam kan dia ajar dua-dua tau, kalau you perhati betul-betul. Dalam Islam dia ajar kita untuk ada that extrovert punya skill dan juga ada introvert punya skill. Contohnya Islam galakkan kita untuk keluar and be a part of the society, be a part of the community. So Islam galakkan kita untuk keluar. At the same time, Islam juga galakkan kita untuk bersendirian, tahajud kan, bersendirian, bertafakur, meditate and also reflect on your life. So dua-dua tu kena ada. Okay, hopefully tu menjawab soalan ya, Salman. Alright, ada lagi soalan yang live datang daripada kawan-kawan kita nah. Oi, banyaknya orang yang ada lagi soalan, tak ada dah. Satu je soalan. Will you save this live? Ya, ya. Saya akan save live video ni. Jangan risau. Jangan risau. Please do not be complacent. Is that a question? Please do not be complacent. Faiza Muhammad, what do you mean by that? Please do not be complacent. Kena terangkan sikit pasal I'm not sure. Not sure. Please come to Egypt and give talk. Please invite me to Egypt. Kena invite lah. Saya bukan kaya pun macam boleh. Boleh senang-senang nak travel. Saya akan save live ni. Saya akan save. Okay. Live ni akan ada. Jangan risau. Saya akan save. Where to buy the book? Book ni. MPH boleh beli. So, saya recommend anda beli kat MPH sekarang sebab ada discount 25%. Tapi boleh juga beli kat tempat lain, kat Iman Shop, which is Iman Publication yang publish buku ni. You boleh beli kat Iman Shop, you boleh beli dekat Kinokuniya, you boleh beli dekat Popular, you boleh beli dekat mana lagi? Kinokuniya, Popular, bookstore-bookstore yang ada kat Malaysia ni lah. InsyaAllah ada buku ni. Tapi MPH saya recommend you beli sekarang sebab ada 25% discount. Discount. Harga buku ni 30 tau. So macam setengah orang macam alah mahalnya. So you ada 25% discount. You boleh beli online atau offline di MPH. Okay. Blah, blah, blah. Okay. So itulah dia soalan yang live. Kita teruskan dengan soalan yang orang dah bagi ni. Alright. I always have doubt in myself to achieve my yearly goal even if I am expert with what I do. I always have doubt in myself, even though I am expert in what I do. Okay. I think that your issue is that you are too perfectionist. You nak benda tu exactly as you planned it. Which is in a way, okay lah. It's good lah. You plan it and you mesti nak harapkan benda tu capai. But really, kita set goal atau aim. The point of it sebenarnya, in my personal opinion, adalah bukannya kita nak achieve goal tu. Hear me out. Okay, follow my train of thought. The point of setting goals adalah supaya kehidupan you ada matlamat. And kehidupan bermatlamat jauh lebih baik daripada kehidupan yang go with the flow, kehidupan yang macam tak apalah nanti aku figure out lah. No, it's not good. Going with the flow akan menyebabkan you Bangun-bangun pagi tak tahu nak buat apa. Bangun-bangun pagi macam, oh, I'll figure something out. Now, there are times when you should go with the flow. Don't get me wrong. But in the foundation of your life should have a plan. You can have a plan. Because that will give your life direction. That will give you, not only that, day tu. Setiap hari tu ada direction. Setiap hari tu ada benda you nak buat. You ada to-do list, you ada jadual, you ada aim, you ada matlamat. So when you tidur malam tu, you rasa macam, yes, I achieve something. And that's good. Because esok you nak bangun, you kena rasa motivated. And that should be every day tau. Should be. Should be. Now obviously this is a jihad setiap orang lah kan. Anyway, that's why you set goal. You nak ada matlamat. Now that doesn't mean that you will never achieve that goal. Mungkin you achieve that goal, alhamdulillah, but you just have to understand that the point of setting aim, setting goal adalah supaya kehidupan you ada kiblat. That's it. Supaya kehidupan you ada arah, ada matlamat, ada motivation, ada somewhere you nak pergi lah. Daripada you imagine it this way tau. You nak main bola, you kena ada goal. Barulah permainan tu ada makna. Ha, makna itu perkataan dia. You nak kehidupan you ada makna. So you main bola, you kena ada goal. Imagine kalau you main bola atau bola keranjang ke atau bola jaring, tak kisahlah, tapi tak ada goal. You nak main apa? So you macam sepak bola situ, sepak bola sini, random tau. Tak ada sebarang direction. But kalau you ada tiang goal, at least you tahu nak pergi mana. And you tahu you nak gelecek bola tu macam mana. And walaupun you sepak tak masuk goal, at least permainan tu ada makna. At least you main tu ada point. And that's like the analogy of life juga. You kena ada goal supaya you main game of life ni dengan ada matlamat, dengan ada direction. Walaupun you tak sepak masuk goal, still game tu ada makna. Sebab tu orang beli tiket nak tengok kan. Alright. Okay. So again, don't be too perfectionist with your goal. Alright. You akan belajar banyak benda dalam perjalanan you nak capai goal tu. So focus on progress. Ha, focus on progress, not perfection. Focus on progress. Selagi mana you progress, selagi itulah you berjaya. Selagi itulah you dikira sebagai orang yang mendekati goal you. So, as long as you mendekati goal tu, walaupun you tak capai goal tu, that's a success. That's a success. So, don't be critical of yourself, but don't be zalim to yourself. Ha, macam itulah. Be critical, be critical to yourself, but don't be zalim to yourself, okay? Is it okay if I don't have a plan now I'm 23? Is it okay? You should have a plan, 23. But it's okay if you don't have everything figured out, okay? 23 is a very young age. I'm 28. Nak dekat 30 dah. Actually, this year I'm 29. Nak dekat 30 dah. Okay. Is it okay? Okay. Now, ada dua jawapan lah. Yes and no. Yes, it's okay because you're still young. You're still young, 23. Banyak lagi benda you kena discover. Banyak lagi benda you kena belajar. And banyak lagi. Saya bukan nak kata you budak-budak. Tak, you bukan budak-budak. You dah dewasa. Let me just make it clear. You dewasa. 23 ni dah cukup tua lah. Okay, dah balik lama dah. You dewasa. It's just that it's okay kalau you tak figure everything out yet because your life is so long ahead of you, insyaAllah. So it's okay if you don't have something, everything figured out. But at the same time, you should have some things figured out. Tau? Macam you kena ada something lah yang you dah figure out. At least when you're 23, at least lah you figure out you minat apa. At least you figure out you minat apa. Okay? At least lah by 23 you figure out like macam you figure out okay, I think that's enough homework kot. You figure out you minat apa. I think that's probably good enough for 23 lah kot. But the thing is, bila kata pasal plan ni kan, kita bukan nak kata yang kita plan macam ibarat macam plan tu akan jadi 100% macam mana kita plan. No. Kita plan, tapi obviously apa yang berlaku tu terletak di tangan Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. Alright? Tapi still kita plan. So just because benda tu tak jadi, tidak semestinya kita kena kata baik tak payah plan kalau macam tu. No. Jangan percaya benda tu. Kita still kena plan because planning itself will give our life meaning and direction. Okay, ada motivation kat situ. Bila kita bangun pagi tu ada benda nak buat kan. So, is it okay kalau you tak ada plan when you're 23? Yes and no. Yes, it's okay. You still young, plenty of things to figure out. But no as well, you kena ada something yang sudah figure out. You're 23, you should dah ada capacity untuk think for yourself. Dah ada capacity to make your own decision. Dah ada capacity untuk at least figure out lah you minat apa. And ada keberanian lah. Ada keberanian untuk nak, apa nama tu? Ada keberanian untuk nak mencuba benda-benda yang baru dan bermanfaat. Okay? So, okay. As a homework, you 23, okay. Cuba imagine you 30 and cuba tanya diri you sendirilah kan. Okay, bila aku 30, orang yang macam mana yang aku nak jadi? Aku nak jadi orang yang macam mana? Orang macam mana aku nak jadi? And bila you tulis benda tu atas kertas, at least you ada a vision. And now you 23, itu vision you waktu tu you 30, you at least boleh letak dah, okay, apakah antara jalan-jalan yang aku boleh pergi untuk nak capai goal di 30 tu. At least that's a good start. Kalau you tersilap, tak apa, jangan risau. Kalau katakanlah you nak ke sini, and you daripada sini, okay, and then you jalan-jalan, oh, tersilap! At least you dah ke depan dah. Daripada you dekat sini dulu tau. So you dah ada progress, nampak tak? Cuma you tersilap, kalau you salah ambil jalan kan. Okay, you mungkin patah balik sikit. Tapi still you takkan patah balik kepada original place. Pasal when you try something, when you experience something, bila you naik, you punya EXP tu, macam terminologi game lah kan. Bila naik, you punya EXP tu, you will never be the same person. You'll never be the same person. So you bukan macam, alamak, waste of time, aku kembali ke square one. No! You ke belakang sikit, but you'll never become the same person again. And that's great. That means you membesar. You grow tau. So yeah. Macam mana nak survive tempat baru? Ni cakap pasal pindah rumah ke? Ataupun tempat kerja baru ke? Ataupun universiti baru ke? Macam mana ni? Okay. Kita ambil general lah. General. Generally speaking, surviving in a new place requires you to be very, very confident. You kena ada confident. Because bila you di tempat baru, everything is an unknown. Betul tak? Everything is like scary lah kan? Benda baru kan? Orang pun baru, tempat pun baru. So, you tak familiar dengan anything lagi. So, the only thing yang familiar at that particular point adalah you. You're the only thing yang familiar. But kalau you pun tidak ada confident dengan diri you sendiri, you berada di tempat baru, you akan cepat shake tau. Oh, shake! Unshakeable! Okay. Anyway, sorry. So, you akan cepat. Sebab itulah nama buku ni unshakeable tau. Sebab bila you ada keyakinan diri yang at least keyakinan diri terhadap diri sendiri. At least keyakinan diri terhadap diri sendiri. Bila you ada keyakinan diri tu, at least you takkan cepat goyah tau. Sebab tu nama dia unshakeable. Saya tak nak you senang goyah. Jangan senang goyah. That's why it's called unshakeable. So, if you want to survive tempat baru, you kena build self-confidence. And, kebetulan, esok malam pukul 8, saya ada kelas tentang macam mana nak bina self-confidence. Online sahaja. You tak payah keluar rumah pun. Online je kelas tu. Esok pukul 8, you boleh pergi ke aimanazlan.com untuk daftar ke kelas tu. Okay? Online je. Dan saya buka pendaftaran, saya extend sikit lah. Sampai esok pukul 5 petang. Esok Sabtu, 12 Januari, 5 petang. Alamak, saya tinggal seminit je. Alah, Instagram tak bagilah lama lah. Okay, dalam masa seminit ni, okay. Okay. Soalan-soalan lain tu, saya dah jawab in some way. Okay, dalam masa seminit. Oh, ada soalan. Berapa harga kelas? Kelas tu harga dia RM49. 2 jam ada worksheet. You boleh access recording kelas tu seminggu. Adalah dia punya advantage dia. You pergi kat saya punya website tu. Semua maklumat ada kat situ. 30 saat! Oh my god! 30 saat. Kalau ada kawan yang cakap nak bunuh diri. Oh, okay, this is serious. Alright, so in 28 seconds. Kalau ada kawan cakap nak bunuh diri, number one, never leave him alone. Never leave him alone. Number two, immediately seek help from professional. And yeah, that's those two things. Never leave him alone and immediately seek help from professional. Counselor, helpline, the suicide helpline, and so on and so forth. 5 seconds! Thank you very much for watching this live event. Until next time, assalamualaikum. Bye-bye!